Hey everyone, welcome to the Nikhil Hogan Show. I'm really excited to introduce my guest today, Professor John A. Rice. He has been a visiting professor at the University of Pittsburgh 2010 to 2011 and the University of Michigan from 2012 to 2013. He has received grants from the Alexander-von-Humboldt Stiftung, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and the American Philosophical Society. He has written many articles, reviews of books, and musical editions, entries in musical encyclopedias and dictionaries, and 6 books, one of which, Antonio Salieri and Viennese Opera, received the Kinkeldey Award from the American Musicological Society. Other notable books include Music in the 18th Century and Mozart on Stage by Cambridge University Press. He has lectured widely in both the United States and Europe. He has served as president of the Mozart Society of America and of the Southwest Chapter of the AMS and as a director at large of the AMS. He is an elected member of the Academie für Mozartforschung in Salzburg. Professor Rice, it's really great to talk to you today.
Well, Nikhil, I'm delighted to be here.
Wonderful. I mentioned in the introduction a bit of your background, but could you tell me a little bit more about your background and how you came to your research?
Well, since I was a teenager, I've loved 18th century music. And I came from a background, family background of not professional musicians, but both my parents loved classical music. And so I basically developed my tastes from them. And my father was also a professor of history. So basically, in my own career, I've combined my parents' love of music with my father's interest in history.
It says you studied music history under Daniel Heartz at the University of California. And that last name is familiar to people of schema theory. That's the name of one of the schema that you popularized. And what was it like studying with Daniel Heartz?
He was a great professor, great mentor. I mean, is. He's now about 90 years old, but still going strong, and great friend and mentor. It was just an incredible privilege to be able to study with him back in the 1980s at Berkeley.
When you were studying in 1987, what was cutting edge then versus now?
Oh, wow. Well, Daniel Heartz was a great specialist in 18th century opera and making all sorts of new discoveries in opera studies. And so I guess you could say that was sort of a cutting edge field at the time. And as I say, it was a great privilege for me to be involved in that kind of work. A lot of my work at Berkeley as a graduate student was in the study of late 18th century opera.
You've published quite a few papers, for instance, on opera seria and opera buffa. Just for my audience, what's the difference between seria and buffa opera?
Oh, wow. Well, the basic difference is one is comic and the other is serious. But musically, you know, we're all familiar with Mozart's opere buffe, and ensembles are really important. Finales are, you know, characteristic parts of comic opera. Opera seria, the basic musical unit is the aria. There are many fewer ensembles. And so I suppose in a nutshell, that's the main difference. Opera buffa tends to be has a lot more variety of different musical styles. There are serious moments, there are comic moments, there's tragedy, there's, as I say, a lot more variety musically and perhaps also dramatically.
And does that draw itself from nationality or more from the poetry or both or other things?
Well, when you're talking about opera buffa and opera seria, that's Italian. And then you have different genres that were being developed in France in the 18th century, tragédie lyrique, you know, the operas of Lully and Rameau. Salieri's operas that he wrote in Paris were very different from the operas that he wrote in Italy or in Vienna.
How has our views on opera changed over the last 10, 20 years from a music historical perspective?
Well, one thing I think that has changed is we appreciate opera seria more, I think, than we used to. For example, Mozart's La Clemenza di Tito was generally not considered to be on a level with his other late operas. And was considered to be a kind of a throwback to an earlier era, kind of a very old-fashioned work. Thanks in part, especially to the work of Daniel Heartz, we now understand that opera seria was developing and was, you know, not at all old-fashioned in at the time Mozart was writing La Clemenza di Tito, and was developing into the kind of operas that we're familiar with in the 19th century, in Rossini, Donizetti, Bellini. There was a constant evolution into the 19th century, of which Mozart's Tito is a part.
Does Italian music play a lot into the 18th century in terms of opera? But for maybe people who are not familiar with opera, what was the music scene like if you were just an average person on the street and you wanted to get some public entertainment?
Well, let's see. I mean, it depends where you were. But in Vienna in the late 18th century, most of the operatic entertainment was Italian, and mostly opera buffa, comic opera. And that's the case also in Prague, for example, where Mozart wrote Don Giovanni and where his other operas were very much appreciated. But then you go to other cities like Paris, and there they had their own very different operatic tastes and preferred opera in French, the Tragédie Lyrique. So again, I mentioned Salieri earlier. When Salieri came to Paris, he was expected to write French opera. And so you get these wonderful operas that he wrote in the 1780s, Les Danaïdes and Tarare are both operas that hardly ever performed anywhere except Paris, where they were extremely popular. But elsewhere, the rest of Europe had different operatic tastes. And so those French operas were rarely exported to other countries.
Now, you mentioned Antonio Salieri, and you wrote a book called Antonio Salieri and the Viennese Opera. Could you talk a little bit about that study of Viennese opera and Salieri and his place in it?
Well, that was a big project that I worked on for about a decade back in the 1990s. And, well, it was a major project, and I spent a lot of time in Vienna in the Austrian National Library, which has a lot of Salieri's manuscript scores. His autograph scores are still there, and I spent hours and hours looking at those scores, studying them. Most of Salieri's music, he wrote about 40 operas, most of which have never been published. So in order to get an idea of what the music is like, I had to actually go to Vienna and spend a lot of time just poring over his autograph manuscripts. It was a wonderful experience.
Professor Rice, some people who popularly know Salieri from the movie Amadeus would say, wait a second, that's the anti-Mozart guy. He's the guy who's not as good as Mozart and was complaining to the crucifix that for his shortcomings. What's the real true picture of Salieri, his talent, and really his place in opera and the 18th century?
He was a very talented composer for the theater. In that respect, quite different from Mozart, who could do wonderful work in any genre. Salieri was one of these composers, like Rossini or Donizetti, who devoted himself almost exclusively to opera. And he was capable of writing incredibly beautiful music and very dramatic music. And I guess if you were just to listen to a couple of his operas, I would recommend where he, I think, really is at his best is in his French operas, where, like, for example, Les Danaïdes. There's a recording of Les Danaïdes with Christophe Rousset and his Les Talons Lyriques that is just really fantastic. And indeed, that's a period instrument group. And Salieri is one of these composers, one of these 18th century composers who really benefits from performances on period instruments. And so that would be, if you were just to listen to one opera of his, that would be the one I would recommend. And I think it would blow you away.
What was the contemporary reception of Salieri? I know also he was also quite a successful teacher, and he was quite a big figure in musical life at the time.
Yes, definitely. He taught Beethoven, Schubert in his later years. And as far as reception of his operas is concerned, again, the French operas were extremely popular for a long time. Les Danaïdes was performed in Paris up until the 1820s, and was very influential on Berlioz. When Berlioz, as a young man, came to Paris and was studying medicine, he went to the opera and went to Les Danaïdes. I think it was around 1820, something like that. And he was so impressed by this opera that that's when he decided to become a composer. So that's a nice indication of how powerful Salieri's, the powerful effect that some of Salieri's music could have. The comic operas, the Italian operas had less staying power. So, for example, most of them had basically fallen out of the repertory by the end of the 18th century.
You released another book, Essays on Opera, in 1750 to 1800. And what was that book about?
Yeah, that's actually a collection. I was just commissioned to make a collection of previously published articles in English about opera during that period. So, I went through a lot of journals and chose, I don't know, it's about 20 articles, I guess, that I thought were the most significant, important articles on opera during that period.
Wasn't opera really the dominant kind of popular entertainment at the time? I mean, nowadays it's concert halls and for more refined listeners, but wasn't it kind of really popular music back in the day?
Well, I think it was even in the 18th century, you still had to have a significant amount of money to go into the theater. So it was maybe middle class and upper class entertainment, primarily. You know, I think it's always been basically a kind of an upper class or a middle to upper class entertainment.
Moving forward, I actually learned about you, Professor Rice, from your really amazing YouTube channel called Settecentista. And what does that mean? Is that an Italian word for something?
Settecentista. It means 18th century person. 18th century.
Right. And I really encourage people to check that out. It has amazing compilations of musical selections that demonstrate a wide variety of things. But the one that I noticed that you put on were examples of musical schema and representative of musical schema theory. How did you get into musical schema theory as we start into this section of the interview?
Yeah. Well, that's all thanks to Robert Yerdegan, whom you know, of course, and his book that was published in 2007, I believe. And that was, I first saw the book soon after it came out, and it was just an incredible revelation for me. I'd been studying this kind, 18th century music for about 30 years already at that point, and yet that book caused me to start listening to the music and understanding the music in a completely new way. And so, it's an amazing, as you know, it's an amazing book and incredibly influential and certainly influenced me a great, great deal.
How did you begin your research? Because you are someone who's uncovered completely new schema. And how did you start to find these schema? For instance, the Hertz, the Lully, the Morte. How did you find these things?
Well, it's hard to reconstruct because they kind of emerge, into one's consciousness. You look at a lot of music and you start to notice things gradually, things that keep coming back up over and over. And then you start to wonder, maybe this is a schema of the kind similar to those or analogous to those introduced by Robert Yerdegan. And so, that's basically what happened.
Which is the first schema that you found?
Well, the first one that I published was the one that I named after my professor, Heartz. And I did that actually copying Yerdegan, because Yerdegan has a schema called the Meyer.
His professor.
After his professor, Leonard Meyer. So right. I thought, I should name one after my professor. Also because Heartz actually referred to this particular musical pattern a lot in his own works. But he never gave it a name, because that's the thing that Yerdegan's kind of big, what we'd call it, his kind of breakthrough was the idea of naming these various patterns. And Heartz often referred to the pattern that I call the Heartz, but each time he referred to it, it was almost as if he was referring to it for the first time because he didn't have a name for it. And so that's really, you know, the only thing that the only new thing that I did was to name something that had already been isolated by my professor.
Did you tell your professor that you named it after him?
Yes.
How did he react?
I hope he was pleased.
And so tell me about the lully, or is it the lully?
Lully. That's a schema it's basically a baseline that where you have a little bit technical for just a second.
Sure, be technical.
A baseline scale degree one that's then sustained while creating a dissonance. Then the baseline resolves down one step to the leading tone and then comes back up again. So 1-7-1 with a suspension. And here again is something that actually Robert Yerdegan refers to this pattern in his book, but he doesn't actually name it. So these patterns kind of, they don't really exist in our minds. We can't really think about them until we have a name for them. And so the only thing I really did was name something that people had already been noticing before.
Talk about the morte as well.
The morte. That's the name I gave to a pattern, a chromatic voice leading pattern in which the treble rises chromatically from 1 to 5 or from 3 to 5, where the bass descends chromatically from 1 down to 5. So you have these two chromatically diverging lines.
And how many times do you have to see a schema before you think it's statistically significant?
The term statistically significant, that suggests some kind of scientific basis.
Right.
And it's really, there is no scientific basis. It's just something you see often, keeps coming up. I never keep count of how many times I see these things. It's just if you start to see something a lot, then it's artistically, aesthetically significant. But I don't know anything about statistics.
Right. And also, when The Art of Partimento was released by Professor Sanguinetti in 2012, how did that also, that cross-pollination work with schema theory in your mind?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. A lot of the patterns are the same. And Sanguinetti occasionally borrows terminology from Yerdegan. But it's hard. I'm not really sure how to put it into words. How the two approaches are very similar, but not identical. I think both books are extremely useful. I have them both on my library shelf, and I use them both a lot.
I have a question regarding overall music schema theory. Are there more schema lurking in the wild, or have we kind of discovered them all, like Pokemon?
This is a question I've wondered about a lot. I mean, especially early on, because Robert Yerdegan's book doesn't ask that question. And you might, reading his book, I think I originally had the impression that basically he had covered everything. And so it took me a long time. I mean, it was, I think my first article on a schema came out, I think, in 2014. So 7 years after his book came out, it took me a long time to start to think, no, there are more schemata out there that are to be uncovered or to be named, at least. Let's put it that way. And I suspect there's still more. I mean, I think it's probably a never-ending process. As you get to know more music, as you get to know the music better, more schemata will emerge. There are other scholars now, you know, there's a recent article, I actually haven't seen it yet, but there's a paper that actually I'm going to hear being delivered in at a conference next February, I think, in Stanford, a schema called Vallejo, which I'm not sure what it is, but I'm looking forward to hearing about it.
Talking about that, in your 2017 article, Voice Leading Schemata and Sentences in Opera Buffa, you say this. You say, Yerdegan's work has had important repercussions in the analysis of Mozart's instrumental music, but few attempts have been made to apply schema theory to Mozart's operas. So could you just elaborate on that a little bit?
Yeah. In Yerdegan's book, a lot of the earlier music that he analyzes and from which he extracts schemata, is operatic music, music of the 1730s, 1740s, 1750s. But when he talks about later music of Haydn and Mozart, for example, in that period, the, say, so the 1780s, 1790s, he refers mostly to instrumental music. And so it seemed to me, as I started to look at Mozart's operas, there was a lot of music that you couldn't really explain using Jurtigen's schemata.
Could you give an example of that? Like, for instance, something that's kind of mystifying if you tried to apply schema theory?
Yeah. Well, like, for example, you get, well, a schema that Dean Sutcliffe, the New Zealand musicologist, Dean Sutcliffe, is called the overture, is something that you find all over the place in opera buffa. That is, which is simply an ascending scale over a tonic pedal. It's something that's just, you know, just a part of the opera buffa vocabulary. And it's so, but you look at it and you can't really figure out how's that. Well, at least you could say, well, it starts with a do, re, mi. That's one of Jurtigen's schemata. But then it keeps going and it's over this tonic pedal. The do, re, mi is supposed to be harmonized 1-5-1, but this isn't harmonized 1-5-1. This is over. So there's an example of where you really need to introduce a new name. And so we're lucky that we have the Dean Sutcliffe introduced that term for that particular device that you find in opera buffa. So it's just one example.
Actually, another thing in that article was interesting. You mentioned the ubiquity of rising lines in opera buffa could potentially cause difficulties in the application of schema theory because Jurtigen's principal schemata are dominated by falling lines, such as the Prinner, the Sol Fa Mi, the Fonte, and lines that rise and fall, like the Romanesca, the Cadenza, the Mea, the Fanarole. So could you talk about this absence, or rather the less emphasis on rising lines in schema theory?
Well, it occurred to me that this may be a difference between opera buffa on the one hand and instrumental music on the other. That instrumental music of the late 18th century features a lot of these schemata that involve some kind of a descent, whether it's a direct descent or some kind of a zigzag descent. And whereas you find all of these, not only the overture, but other schemata in opera buffa that involve rising lines. And so it's just occurred to me that this is maybe a difference between operatic music and or theatrical music, perhaps, and instrumental music.
Socially, what was the instrumental music really used for in that era? Was it used for private concerts, public concerts, functions, these kinds of music that we see all the time? What were they really used for?
There was a lot of music in the home. I suppose that's maybe the main difference between the way so-called classical music is used today and the way it was used at the time it was written. Mozart, let's say, when he was writing a string quartets, he was thinking essentially of music to be played privately in the home. It wasn't really concert music. And really chamber music in general was music for private consumption, and often by amateur musicians. Whereas piano concertos and symphonies, these were public works that would have been performed in concerts that were not too different from concerts today, except perhaps that, I guess the main difference was that concerts in Mozart's time would typically involve a mixture of vocal music and instrumental music. And so that's much less the case today.
Talking about another schema that mentioned in Jurtigen's book, Music in the Glanzstil, the Monte Romanesca, you actually say this about it. You say that the term alludes to the features of the patterns that resemble features of the Monte, which is a schema, and the Romanesca, another schema. Like the Monte and the Romanesca, it's a rising sequence. But you say, I would go a little further and saying explicitly that the Monte Romanesca is neither a Monte nor a Romanesca, but a schema with its own long history and its own set of expressive connotations. Could you talk about the Monte Romanesca?
Yeah, that term is one of Robert Jurtigen's terms. So basically that article is just refining and taking Robert Jurtigen's ideas and developing them a little bit and finding more examples of this particular schema, which is one of my favorites. And it was used in that article. I connect it with the idea of the sublime, because it seems to have been used by composers to in moments when they wanted to kind of lift their listeners up into a kind of a new to a new level. So you find it in religious music and opera, instrumental music. You find it all over the place, but typically reserved by composers, saved by composers for moments of particular sublimity.
And what is the sublime? I mean, what does that really mean?
Oh, gosh. Well, it was an aesthetic category that was of great interest in the 18th century. There's a famous treatise by Burke on the sublime, the beautiful and the sublime. And it was basically a kind of the equivalent of greatness. The sublime was great, was vast, was impressive, was, ineffable. It's hard to describe.
Right, right. Does that have to do with something rising? Does the rising nature of the schema have something to do with the kind of mimicking that feeling?
Yes, definitely. Definitely, yes.
You've used this voice leading schemata to analyze, in another article, the quartet from Mozart's Idomeneo. It's really nice because you can really using the schema, you break it down in a way that's quite easy to understand. And could you talk a little bit about the analysis? And that's really part of opera. And how did you find, how effective was schema theory in analyzing that quartet?
Oh, I think it's very, very useful. The great quartet in Idomeneo is just really almost every measure can be understood as being a manifestation of one schema or another. And the way Mozart uses them, he uses them extremely effectively. So he saves that the Monte Romanesca until almost the very end of the quartet, when the emotions are at their very peak. And so it's a very effective use of schemata of all different kinds.
I'm going to flip it now and say, what are the limitations of schema theory?
Oh, gosh. You know, I haven't really thought about that. It's obviously just one set of tools in the toolbox. There are many aspects of music that you can't explain using schema theory. It's just, it's schemata are one parameter of many parameters that composers exploit when they're writing music. Dynamics, instrumentation, there's so many, large scale form, all of these other parameters are equally important.
What's been the most surprising thing to you about your research in this area?
Well, I guess it's just that here I am, I was about 55, I guess, something like that, when Jurtigen's book came out, 56. And so, I thought I knew pretty much everything about 18th century music. And, I'd been studying it for several decades. And then all of a sudden, there was this revelatory experience that I had where I got to hear this music that I thought I knew really well in a new way. And that was incredibly surprising and rewarding.
Now I want to actually talk about the new area of research that you've been moving to. You've moved from schemata theory into something very interesting, something about Saint Cecilia, is that right?
Yes. I'm returning to something I was working on way back when I was in graduate school, back in the 1980s at Berkeley. We had several professors there who were very interested in Renaissance music, including Anthony Newcomb and Joseph Kerman. And I took seminars with both of them. And so I was very interested in Renaissance music. And I discovered that a whole bunch of motets were written in the 16th century dedicated to Saint Cecilia.
Professor Rice, just to jump in, for people who don't know, who is Saint Cecilia and why is she significant?
Well, she was a legendary figure. We don't know if she even existed, but she was Christians of the in the Middle Ages and the Renaissance believed that she was a one of the principal virgin martyrs. She lived in and that she lived in ancient Rome, and that she married she was devoted to Christ, but married a young man. And on her wedding night, she told her husband that she had an angel, a guardian angel, who would kill anybody who slept with her. And so she was warning her husband, "You can't have sex with me, or you're going to die." And so he then converted to Christianity, and he agreed to. They lived together as a married couple, but without having sex. And she converted a big bunch of other people to Christianity. But I guess the important point for this discussion is that she had absolutely nothing to do with music. The only connection with music is that there's a description of her wedding where it said that while instruments were playing, the instruments that were celebrating the wedding or the wedding feast, while the instruments were playing, she, Cecilia, prayed to God alone. And that phrase, this cantantibus organis, means while the instruments or while the organs were playing, that phrase then became associated with her. And later on in the Middle Ages, when artists needed some kind of a symbol to help people identify Cecilia, they took the organ. They had her holding an organ or standing next to a little organ, a little portable organ, and that's how she became connected with music. It's a strange story, but in the Renaissance, then composers started to basically were inspired by these artistic representations of Cecilia with an organ and started to write music in her honor. And composers adopted her as, and musicians adopted her as their patron saint.
Can you give examples of some musicians who were the first ones that we know of that started to use her as an inspiration?
It starts with the generation after Josquin des Prez. So Josquin des Prez was active around the end of the 15th century, the beginning of the 16th century. Then in the next generation, you get composers like Gombert, Clemens Non Papa, Crequillon. These were the big composers of the from the 1530s, 1540s, 1550s. Are the composers who started to write motets in honor of Cecilia.
What were they using her as an example? What were the stories about in the songs? And it's not instrumental music, right? Was it part of?
This is all vocal, but all vocal.
All vocal,
music.
Right? Okay.
Yeah. So, a cappella.
So what kind of, how would the text, how would that look like?
Mostly these liturgical texts from basically the texts that had been used in plain chant, in Gregorian chant. And those texts were mostly borrowed from this original, the so-called Passion of St. Cecilia, the original story, legend of St. Cecilia that goes back to possibly as far back as the 5th century. And that's where this phrase cantantibus organis comes from. And and so many of the motets use that, begin with those words, cantantibus organis, or they use other prayers from the liturgy for St. Cecilia's Day. So, yeah, they don't. Then there are a few, the ones that kind of reflect the newest understanding of her as a patron of music, there are a few new texts that actually refer to St. Cecilia's Day as a day when musicians celebrate her by singing, especially. And so many of these motets, I think, were actually written for musicians to sing as part of their celebrations of Cecilia's Day.
Where was that phrase found again?
The Passion of St. Cecilia, Passio Sancte Cecilie.
Now, why do you think she really resonated with the musicians?
Well, it was the ubiquity of these pictures that you find in medieval manuscripts of Cecilia with an organ.
When did organs start to come into the world of music?
Oh, they go way back to antiquity.
Wow.
To ancient Rome.
Yeah. No kidding.
In the Middle Ages, you see a lot of images of these portable organs that you could hold. You'd have it positioned on your thigh, and you'd have to pump the bellows with one hand and play the keyboard with the other hand, and that's a portative organ. And also positive organs, the ones that you put on a table, were I think quite common already in the late Middle Ages and Renaissance.
How widespread was she once they started to take her on as an image and started to use her?
Well, this whole association between Saint Cecilia and music seems to have started in the Netherlands, in the what is now Belgium, the Low Countries, Belgium, what is now Belgium, the Netherlands. And so a lot of the earliest music written for Saint Cecilia was written by composers that were active in that part of Europe. Then later in the 16th century, the interest in Cecilia spread to other parts of Europe, including Italy. And so actually the book that I'm working on will end in 1599, because that's the year in which there was an archaeological exploration of St. Cecilia's church in Rome, and a body was discovered that was believed to be St. Cecilia's body. And there was a big reburial ceremony right at the end on St. Cecilia's Day, 1599, that involved a lot of music. And it seemed to me that would be the perfect place to end my investigation of St. Cecilia in the Renaissance.
And to this day, is she still invoked in liturgy and church music?
Sure. But I guess the golden age of St. Cecilia music was the late 17th, early 18th century, with music by Purcell and Handel and other composers. And she was very popular and in England during that period. And that's probably the period that produced the greatest and music that's most familiar to us today on the theme of St. Cecilia.
You're an expert in the 18th century, and you also Renaissance music and medieval music. What is interesting to you about Renaissance music musically?
Well, it's very, very different. I mean, there are connections. One does see some of the schemata that we're familiar with from the 18th century. You see a few of those already emerging in Renaissance music, but in general, the style was very, very different. But it's still, you know, based on triads, and with some of the same harmonic progressions that one finds in later music. And it's interesting to see the modes in Renaissance music as they gradually coalesce. I mean, you have a number of different modes that gradually coalesce towards the major and the minor mode that we're familiar with from later music. So the roots of the common practice are there in Renaissance music, but there are a lot of differences too.
Back in Mozart's time, the Renaissance music wouldn't have seemed too ancient to them by any means. So were they well-versed in Monteverdi and that kind of music in their day?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question, because I've wondered about this a lot, how their someone like Mozart's conception of...
Because it was only a hundred years ago.
Yeah, but I think, basically, I don't think he knew any of that music. Possibly when he was in Italy, he might have heard... Well, he did hear, we know he heard that Miserere, that was still being performed in the Sistine Chapel, the Miserere by Allegri. That's a piece from the early 17th century, that was still regarded as a masterpiece in his time, but there were very few pieces like that. Really, you know, music that was more than about 50 years old, I think, that Mozart would have heard. How did he feel his own music would be? Would he have been confident, let's say, that his own music would have been listened to, say, 100 years or 200 years after it was composed? If he was thinking about the way earlier music was treated in his own time, he couldn't have been very confident, I think, that his own music would be understood in 200 or 300 years.
Wasn't he kind of a harbinger of the new popular style and was not too interested in the older, strict style of music?
I wouldn't say that because, you know, when he did encounter the music of Bach, for example, he admired it. You know, he thought it was great, and he had great respect for Bach and Bach's music, J.S. Bach. He was a master of counterpoint himself, and he had great respect for contrapuntal composers like Bach. Whether he would have admired the work, the music of Palestrina, I just don't know, or Josquin des Prez, I don't know. And I suspect he would have thought they were kind of dull, but I don't know.
Can you actually recommend some music that perhaps is not well known, like 18th century music, that maybe that you really feel that, man, I really wish more people knew this piece or this opera or this instrumental work? Are there some pieces that really are so great that are not popularly known that you think are really great? Because I'd love to know them.
Yeah, I've already mentioned Salieri's Les Danaïdes, of which there's a very nice recording by Rousset and Les Talents Lyriques. Let's see, I've gotten very fond of. There's a recording on YouTube of a Miserere by Bernasconi. There's a composer that not many people know about, Andrea Bernasconi. That's just a lovely piece and beautifully performed. Those are the two that occur to me just at this moment.
How about an opera, like an opera that is not as famous as like a Figaro, but just is a great opera? Like you mentioned the Salieri one.
Yeah. Paisiello's Barber of Seville is a lovely work. Il Barbiere di Siviglia on the libretto, almost the same as the one that Rossini set to music later. And both is a beautiful work and really interesting from a historical point of view, because Mozart had it in his head when he was writing his own Figaro, which is basically a sequel to Paisiello's opera.
Professor Rice, I mean, it's been such a pleasure to talk to you. I want to ask, what do you have planned for the rest of the year and for 2020? What research, what books, articles, conferences? Just let my audience know.
Well, in a couple of weeks, I'm going to a conference in Spain, in Andalusia, Baeza, a conference on the Gallant style the Iberian Peninsula and in Latin America. And so I'm looking forward to that. Basically, though, you know, my Sicilia project is, I've got to spend a lot of, the book is basically done, but now I need to find a publisher and the book will need to be edited, copy edited, proofread, and so that's going to take a lot of my time in the next couple of years.
When do you ballpark you think that the book will be published, all things being well?
Maybe 2 years from now, something like that. Yeah, academic publishing takes a long time.
And you've published quite a few books, you would know. Well, Professor Rice, it's been really such a pleasure. I mean, you're such an expert. I've really loved reading your articles and your YouTube channel. Again, I must stress, go to that YouTube channel. It's got so much great material on it, and you can really learn a lot. So many great exemplars, that's the word that people use now. Examples and exemplars of music and this schema and more things, other stuff as well. Check out his books. And if somebody wanted to get more material, what website should they check out if they want to follow your work?
Well, a lot of my stuff now is available on academia.edu. That's probably the best place to go, in addition to the Settecentista YouTube channel.
Well, Professor Rice, thank you so much. Please come on again when your next article or book drops. I'd love to continue this conversation. Thank you so much and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you very much, Nikhil.